إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran verse 103 بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تتفرقوا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse, introducing a very important concept in a command form. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. Make sure to hold firm, hold fast to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do not dispute, do not disperse. And always remember with thankfulness the great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on you. When you use not to like each other, when you were enemies, hearts repelled, and it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that turned things around and made your hearts come together. And by His blessings and by His grace, you are brothers and sisters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us here, وَاعْتَصِمُوا. Translated as hold firm, the translation is not very accurate. الاعتصام الاحتماء. When we say وَاعْتَصِمْ, seek shelter, seek refuge, seek protection. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us here is what, when you go through the journey of this life, there are things that you need to seek shelter from. There are things you will need to be protected from. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces us to one thing. Yes, in this life there will be things that we must be guarded against. And the way to guard ourselves against this thing is unity. Make sure when you go in this life, you're going to encounter conflict of interests. You're going to encounter differences. Sometimes your benefit is my harm. Sometimes I hate something, you like something. What happens? A company is getting acquired. For one person, he wants it to happen because he's going to get a raise, he's going to get money. For the other person in the same company, he's going to be laid off. There is now a conflict of interest. He wants it, he does not want it. Sometimes, as I said, I have an opinion, you have a different opinion. I see that the best way, the roadmap should be this way for the masjid. Another person say, no, that's wrong. That is the best way. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that is natural. When you pass through this life, there will be conflicts. Sometimes between a brother and his own brother, a wife and her husband. Sometimes between community members. Sometimes between countries. So Allah warn us, let not those conflicts of interest, difference of opinion, lead to disputation, lead to furqa, lead that the hearts repel each other, that we call each other names, that we hate each other, that we fight each other, that we shed the blood of each other. Brothers and sisters, sometimes we have difference of opinion. If I was to tell you about my personal opinion about should we celebrate the Mawlid of the Prophet, should we celebrate the Prophet's birthday or not? If I stand here and tell you my opinion, what happens? A part of you that agrees with me will be very happy with me. Some other people that disagrees with this opinion of mine, it's okay to disagree. But guess what happens? They call me names. I become a mubtada. They will not hear anything I say anymore. They become angry at me. And our manners go low. And we start fighting. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a mercy to mankind. So sometimes when we have a difference of opinion, it can lead to what? Dispersion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, you need protection from that kind of dispersion. You need protection because in this life, there indeed you'll experience this conflict. Everybody experiences a conflict. But how can we, with all our differences and conflict, become one? Allah is saying in a very simple way, around the one, around Allah, around la ilaha illallah, about when it's about the love of Allah and His Messenger, that is strong enough of a force to unite all of us together. Brothers and sisters, I'll say it quickly. There is usually two ways to unite people. Two ways. One way, the easy way, very powerful, will unite people immediately. We unite about what? A common goal of someone to hate. We can unite about the government is bad. we can unite about, and people use that in politics, and we saw that recently. There are certain politicians that the way to gather people around them, of the problem of this country is the immigrants, the problem of the Muslims. Did you notice this? And then people rally for them. They're uniting people about what? One enemy, a big bad wolf, if you will. And Muslims, we have that too. If you remember in Afghanistan, the Russians came, enemy. And people came together, but what brought them together, what united them, is the enemy. He's bad, he's bad, he's bad. What happens when you reach your goal and the enemy is gone? We saw what happened. The uniting force of hate is never going to cause people to build. It can unite us to fight, to destroy. But eventually, when we reach your goal, what happens? We fight among each other and we'll kill each other. This is not the way the Quran introduces. Not only that Allah is telling us unite, but our unity is not you have a common enemy. This is not how Muslims unite. Your unity is about what? The love of Allah and His Messenger. Hablillah, the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That kind of unity builds. And I want to introduce this to you today through a story. That sometimes in this life, we will experience conflicts of interest. Sometimes in this life, nay, disputation will happen between us. How to resolve that? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His love of Him and His Messenger, can really unite hearts that differ, hearts that are in conflict? And the story I wanted to share with you is from the stories of the companions with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Is the best of people, the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, nay, the best among them, the people of Badr. Those people, the 300 people that went with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, changing the face of history. Turning point for Islam, the great battle of Badr. We all know the story of the battle of Badr and how great it was. But something happened after that battle that we do not pay attention to. After the battle was over, the companions, those great as-sabiqun al-awwalun, great people, they disputed with each other. And they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in conflict, fighting with each other. What's going on? They came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A group of them said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, we fought. We got war booty. I got it. It belongs to me. I fought for it." And another group said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, when we fought and they started running away, we could have collected war booty, but we chose to go after them. We chose to make sure that they do not regroup and attack again. So we put our attention in what? We're not going to get war booty. We're going to chase those people. Surely we could have got war booty, but we didn't. So we have a share too, right?" A third group said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, when we won, our biggest focus was you, the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We wanted to make sure nobody will do anything to you. So instead of collecting war booty, instead of chasing people, we chose to stand around you to guard you, lest something would happen to you. So, and we didn't collect the war booty. So we have a share too, right? You should give us some too." And they started disputing with each other. A conflict happened. One of the companions, Sa'd ibn Malik, narrates for us his own personal story. He said the following: "After the battle of Badr, I went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and I said, 'قلت يا رسول الله قد شفاني الله اليوم من المشركين فهب لي هذا السيف.'" After the battle, I went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, "What a wonderful battle! Allah, it's a major victory." And he found in that battle, he fought and he managed to get a sword. You know, like sometimes you fight someone, you take his, and that sword was so beautiful. And he told the Prophet, "All what I'm asking you." And he fought vigorously, he fought with courage, strong. And he said, "All what I want, just please let me keep that sword that I earned in that battle with my courage. Can you please let me keep that sword for me?" And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells him, "That sword, هذا السيف ليس لي ولا لك فضعه هنا." This sword does not belong to you, does not belong to me. Put it right there. And Sa'd ibn Malik said, "فوضعته." And I placed the sword. But then he complied. But he said, "فوضعته ثم رجعت فقلت." I placed it and then I walked away telling myself, "عسى أن يعطي هذا السيف من لم يبلي بلائي." Perhaps he's going to give that sword to someone who did not fight as vigorously as me. You know what he's saying? I fought for that sword. I earned that sword. And now that sword might go to someone who didn't fight at all. It will go for someone that didn't even deserve it. He might give it to someone. I was the one. So he's speaking about what he's not happy. And then all of a sudden, he's having those negative thoughts in his head. A voice calls from behind him. What happened? "Ya Sa'd ibn Malik, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is asking you for you back. What happened?" "Quran has been revealed. And Sa'd ibn Malik said, قلت قد أنزل الله في شيء. When I heard that, I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed something regarding me. Are you following? What happened? I had bad thoughts regarding Muhammad sallallahu and all of a sudden he's telling me, come back, Quran has been revealed. What will Allah do? How will Allah resolve this conflict? That's what we need to learn. We learn a lot about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way he treats us when such things happen. We learn a lot about ourselves and how to mediate when we have conflicts of interest from this kind of a situation. This is not just a situation between the companions. Look, brothers and sisters, if it happened between the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't you think it will happen between me and you? Don't you think it will happen in our masajid? Don't you think it will happen in our religious organizations? It will. It will. But we need to learn how to turn back to Allah to resolve such kind of conflicts. What will Allah do? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now reveals Surah Al-Anfal, Surah number 8 in the Quran. Highly recommend you read it with that context in mind. And the surah starts, we'll go quickly, a thematic approach if you will. The surah starts, يسألونك عن الأنفال. The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts this surah. They ask you, O Prophet of Allah, they ask you regarding Al-Anfal. Translated, they ask you regarding the spoils of war. But the translation is not accurate. Spoils of war is not Al-Anfal. Spoils of war is Al-Ghanaim. Allah did not say, يسألونك عن الغنائم. He said Al-Anfal. What is Nafl? What does it mean in Arabic? We know the word Nafl. We know it very well. In prayers, did you pray your Nafl? What does it mean? Did you pray your extra prayers? Nafl is extra. Nafl is what? The over and above. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first lesson, look at what Allah is saying. They are disputing. They are asking you regarding what? Those extra things, those secondary things, those over and above things. Those are not the main thing. They're disputing, they're fighting regarding Al-Anfal. And by Allah, how many times do we fight each other, brother and a brother, a man and a wife, over Al-Anfal? And we lose the main point. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does say what? What you're fighting over, this worldly gain, is not the main point. It means you lost focus. يسألونك عن الأنفال. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to that. قل, tell them, الأنفال لله وللرسول. Tell them, this war booty, the Anfal, belongs to Allah and His Messenger. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَأَصْلِحُوا ذَاتَ بَيْنِكُمْ. So have taqwa of Allah, be God mindful, and mend the relations between you. What's going on here? Now we have a hadith from Ubadah ibn al-Samit, and he says the following, فِينَا أَصْحَابُ بَدْرِ نَزَلَتْ سُورَةَ الْأَنْفَالِ. In us, the people of Badr, this surah was revealed. عندما, when we disputed regarding the war booty, وَسَاءَتْ فِيهِ أَخْلَاقُنَا. We disputed regarding the war booty, and our manners was ugly in the way we disputed. This conflict of interest brought something negative. And beware, when we say سَاءَتْ أَخْلَاقُنَا, it's on their level, not on our level. Their level is different than our level. But he says what? Our manners wasn't appropriate. This conflict of interest led, we said things that we shouldn't have. Our manners was not good, was ugly, according to them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did what? So he said, فَنَزَعَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ أَيْدِينَا وَجَعَلَهُ لِلرَّسُولِ. When our manners was ugly, Allah took it away from our hands and gave it all to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the lesson here? Very important lesson for me and you. You know when you take your kids, you want to do something good, you take them to a theme park and you spend money and you have a wonderful day and then over and above you get them a lollipop. And then all of a sudden they forget everything and they start fighting each other regarding the lollipop. And he calls his brother names and his brother starts to beat him up. And what does a father do in that case? Did you forget everything? You're going to fight over a lollipop? If that is the case, usually the parent does what? Give me back that lollipop. Give me. That was supposed to be an extra thing. Now you're going to fight over it and forget all what I did for you. You're going to forget the theme park. You're going to forget everything and fight over this. Give it back to me. If it's going to cause you to fight, I'll take it back. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does the same with the believers. Be very careful. That's what the companion said. When we fought regarding this war booty, what did Allah do? He took it back from us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a mercy to mankind. Rahmah. And when the mercy to mankind, the unifying force, becomes the reason why I differ with you, why I call you names, why my manners become so ugly, when the masjid that was supposed to be the place of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes the reason why we call each other names, why we call the police, why we hate each other. Allah takes the rahmah away from us and we are deprived. Be very careful. Disputation with bad manners leads to deprivation for everyone. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? Al-anfalu lillahi wa rasul. And then commands the believers, what? Be God conscious. Obey Allah in kuntum mu'mineen. And now we see how Allah is going to handle that conflict. How he's going to resolve it. He says, obey Allah and his messenger if you were truly believers. And then when you read the second verse, you would expect what? You'd expect the ruling. يسألونك عن الأنفال. They ask you regarding الأنفال. Therefore, the second verse should be what? The ruling is this. The ruling does not come in the second verse, nor the third verse, nor the fourth verse. The ruling comes in the verse number 40. And there is a lesson. Sometimes people might come to you. Sometimes people would go to the sheikh and they would ask a question. What is the ruling regarding this? And we are so hasty to do what? Answer. Some people are not ready to receive the answer yet. So before saying the answer, prepare the person in front of you. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing. Before telling you the ruling, your heart needs to be prepared so it's able to carry it. Allah is addressing what's wrong with you? What led to that? Why are your akhlaq that bad? What happened? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts saying what? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. True believers are the ones. Who are the believers? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Believers are the ones when the ayat of Allah are revealed, their heart trembles. Those who have reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who establish salah. Those who spend money. What's going on here? This is not a switch of topic. Allah is reminding them. Did you forget who you are? You are the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did you forget what your life was about? You, that's not befitting. You're fighting regarding the war booty? Really? You're the people of salah. You're the people that spend money. You're the people of tawakkul, reliance. You're the people that receive the verses of Allah. You're the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is not befitting for you. And that is a lesson for me and you too. When my son does something wrong, how do you speak to him? Oh, what a stupid thing. You fool. Don't do that. That destroys his self-esteem. But look what Allah did. Allah doesn't do that. Allah, it's like telling my son, you took an F in the exam. Why? You take an F, that's not befitting. What happened? You're a straight A student. You have the capability. See how positive the message is. Allah's doing the same thing. You're really disputing regarding al-anfal? Are you really disputing regarding celebrating the Prophet of the Prophet ﷺ's birthday and you're calling each other names? Did you forget who you are? Did you forget the mission? Did you forget the surrounding? Did you forget the challenges we have? And you're fighting over this? Did you forget what are you about? This is the unifying force. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reorients them. You are the believers. You're the people of salah. You're the people of tawakkul. You're the people of infaq. This is who you are, the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now starts doing something more amazing. It is not a switch of topic. Allah tells them how the battle started. Did you forget? كَمَا أَخْرَجَكَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَيْتِكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكَارِهُونَ. What a powerful verse. Allah starts saying what? Rewinding things. Did you forget how that battle started? It was Allah himself that caused you to exit your house. It was him. Our houses are our places of dwelling, our places of safety. Sometimes that's what we want. We want to be safe. I want to be happy. I don't want a conflict. I don't want fear. I don't want to have any negative experience in this life. Nothing bad. But sometimes it is Allah that makes us exit our places of comfort. That's what he told the Prophet. It was Allah. You were in your bayt in Medina. But Allah was the one that pushed you out from your house, from your dwelling. وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكَارِهُونَ. And the party of the believers, they hated it. They disliked it. What's going on here? When you know how the battle started. The battle of Badr was not a battle. It started by what? A caravan. Those people took the money of the believers in Mecca and they placed it in a caravan and they're going to make a trade with it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them permission to do what? Go, take your money back. So it's an easy thing. Oh, we go raid the caravan. It's protected by 40 people. We're 300 people. Easy. We like that. You see that? I like that. I can go and it's my right, it's justice. I go, raid that caravan, easy, I take my money back. Right? But something happened. On the way, news reached Abu Sufyan and the caravan and he realized what's going on. He evaded them and Mecca sent an army towards them, 1,000 people and they're only 300 and not well armed. And now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells them, Allah is promising you one of those two, either the caravan or the army will be yours. And now the Quran describes how they felt. إِذْ يَعِدُكُمُ اللَّهُ إِحْدَى الطَّائِفَتَيْنَ أَنَّهَا لَكُمْ. Allah was promising you, one of those two will be yours. وَتَوَدُّونَ أَنَّ غَيْرَ ذَاتِ الشَّوْكَ تَكُونُ لَكُمْ. And you wished, you loved that the one that is easy, the one that doesn't have any thorns, the caravan would be yours. You wanted what? You wanted ease. You wanted safety. You wanted no negativity. You wanted no confrontation. You wanted the easy path. You wanted your money. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted something else. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَنْ يُحِقَّ الْحَقَّ بِكَلِمَاتِهِ وَيَقْطَعَ دَابِرِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And Allah wanted to establish the truth from Him on your hands. And what's going on here? Multiple lessons, brothers and sisters. First of all, the first very important lesson. The first verse said what? Allah is the one that made you exit your house. And some of the believers hated it. What does that mean? Sometimes a believer, a command of Allah might come, a decree of Allah might come, and I don't like it. I hate it. I don't. And that's what the verse is saying. وَفَرِيقًا مُمْ. You didn't like it, but they complied. And please, brothers and sisters, this is a very important lesson for a believer. What directs my life? What is driving me? What is driving you, brothers or sisters? In this life, what is the driving force? Many people, their driving force is their feelings, the way they feel. I want to be happy. I don't want to be sad. I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to feel any misery. I don't want to feel rejection. They're directed by experiential avoidance. I don't want to experience any fear. And therefore, my action serves that. We should not change our behavior to change the way we feel. A believer changes his behavior to live according to his values and his morals. It is not about having a happy life. Please remember that. The goal of a believer is not to live a happy life, a life void of problems. I'd rather have a meaningful life, a life with values, with morals, with meaning in it, with purpose, even if I was not happy, than to have a happy life, life of joy, but what was the purpose? What was the meaning? So a believer of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes Allah would decree something and you'd look inside, there is fear, there is sadness, I don't want that. It's okay to hate it. But a believer complies. I comply although I do not like it. That's what Allah is saying regarding them. They complied. And look now what happens. When they complied, what was the reward of it? What did Allah intend? Ya Allah, why? The caravan is easier. An army? Why? That's so hard. People will get killed. I'm afraid. And look at what Allah is telling them. Look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is honoring the believers. He's telling them, you wanted the easy path. You wanted the money. You wanted the caravan. But I wanted something else. If I left you to what you want, how would it have been recorded in history? 300 people went, they raided a caravan. It's justice, they took back their money. Alhamdulillah. But when you complied with me, I wanted to give you something more than money. I wanted to establish Islam on your hands. I wanted to enforce al-haq, the truth on falsehood. And I've selected you. I pushed you to be the ones that will establish Islam to the day of judgment on your hands. I wanted to honor you by giving you that honor. But you did not like it. They, brothers and sisters, the people that complied with Allah, do you understand? They became the people of Badr. They're the people that up till today we speak highly about. That's what Allah wanted to give you. Had it been left to you, you would went for the caravan. But Allah wanted you to be the means by which the truth and His word will be established in this life. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds them of what He did for them. إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ أَنِّي مُمُدِّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ. When you were in the battlefield and Allah starts showing them that you're fighting, did you forget what Allah did for you? When you went and you complied with Allah and the battle started and you were afraid, and you started raising your hands, asking Allah for help. And Allah responded, you are the people. You know, you forget, brothers and sisters, you are supposed to be the people. Allah is saying, when you raise your hand, I respond. So Allah is telling them, you, when you raised your hands, look what I gave you. I responded, I sent 1,000 angels for you to help you. Why 1,000 angels? Isn't one angel enough? One angel can destroy everyone. Why 1,000? Why, Ya Rabb? And Allah mentions that. وَمَا جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بُشْرَى لَكُمْ وَلِتَطْمَئِنَّ بِهِ قُلُوبُكُمْ. And Allah sent 1,000 angels. You know what the purpose is? Not to bring you victory. وَمَا النَّصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. Victory was directly from me. But when I saw your heart is shaky, when I saw that you need steadfastness, and you raised your hands because you were afraid, you raised your hands from the battlefield after complying, I responded. I sent the best of the creation, angels, not one, not two, not 100, 1,000, to show you how much you mean for me. You're the believers. When you ask, I respond, and I respond in a way befitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and befitting to your rank in my eyes. The believers need help. 1,000 angels. That is how much Allah wanted to honor you. The best of creation was means to bring you to be steadfast. And you are my means to bring victory to Islam and Haqq in this life. That is how much Allah honored them. And look at this verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ يُوحِي رَبُّكَ إِلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَنِّي مَعَكُمْ فَثَبِّتُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. When Allah told the angels, and there is two ways to understand it. When Allah told the angels, I am with you, go make the believers steadfast. The second way to understand this verse, more powerful. Allah reveals to the angels, أَنِّي مَعَكُمْ, I am with the believers. Do you understand? Go down, I'm already there with them. Go down and help bring victory. Go down and make them steadfast. How much would you, anyone here, would give if you were to hear Allah saying, أَنِّي مَعَكْ, I am with you. After that, are you going to fight regarding what? The worldly things? How much money you're going to get in your divorce or and you're going to call each other names? You are the believers. أَنِّي مَعَكُمْ. And when people heard that, you can imagine their state elated. Allah saying this about us. And it goes further. Look, brothers and sisters, this is a lesson for me and you. Sometimes we are in our baytu, in the West, me and you. We have been safe in the West. We have been living a good life in the West. And there is nothing wrong in that. And I want safety. I don't want fear. But Allah is pushing us from the zones of comfort. Lately, things are happening outside that we do not like. And we are being pushed to speak. We're being pushed not to just sleep and do nothing like what we were doing before. We're forced to go out and we hate it. But those who are going, although they hate it, although they don't prefer it, they don't want conflicts, they're afraid. Yes, there is fear. But they would comply with what Allah wants anyway, like those people. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring victory to Islam on their hands. Perhaps what Allah wants is that He selected this generation, me and you, to go and there is a conflict, there is a problem outside. Go and comply because perhaps Allah wants to give you. I favor safety. But perhaps Allah wants to give you and me to be the generation that will change the perception of Islam in the West on our hands. And we can only get that when we comply with Allah, although we feel fear, although we feel sad, although there are casualties. But we want a meaningful life, brothers and sisters. I don't want a life free from fear, I want a life that is full of meaning, a life full of purpose, even if I do not like it. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد. Now, the verses continues of Surah Al-Anfal, and please read it. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps reminding them of what He did for them. What are they about? And we need to learn that. What is your mission? My mission and your mission is not an easy life. Yes, I like an easy life. I do not like a hard life. But I want a life of purpose. I comply with Allah and His will, even if I hate it. Taking my feelings with me. Right? Remember Sa'd ibn Malik, how we started this, the man that came to the Prophet with the sword, right? And he said, the Prophet told him what? This sword is not for you or me. Put it here. And he complied. He complied, although he hated it. And he went back and he said, what? Remember the story? Perhaps he's going to give that sword for someone else. What happened now? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called him, as we saw. Surah Al-Anfal is revealed. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells him the following. Because in Surah Al-Anfal, the ruling was given in verse number 50. 1/5 of the war booty belongs to Allah and His Messenger. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called that Sa'd ibn Malik back and he said, when you asked me for that sword, it wasn't for me or for you. So I asked you to put it here. Now that Surah Al-Anfal is revealed, Allah said 1/5 of the war booty belongs to me. That sword belongs to me. And I'm going to give it back to you. Take the sword. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, compassion to mankind. But what's the moral? When we comply with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when we comply with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although we don't understand why, although we hate it, we get the very things that we gave away. But if that man chose to say, it's not just, what is this? I object. He would be surely deprived in this life and in the hereafter. That's the entire moral here. The people of Badr, they did not want to go to Badr. They wanted to go to the caravan. They hated it, but they complied. And they were given. They were given the honor of being people, the people of Badr. Those very people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, Al-Anfal, the war booty belongs to Allah. They complied. They didn't like it. They were given. Similarly, brothers and sisters, things will happen in this life. Conflicts will happen. Remember, we are not about feeling good in conflicts. We're about uniting about one purpose in conflicts. And I want just to leave you with one story here. One story about how the love of Allah and His Messenger can really unite hearts. And we'll finish with this. Because sometimes conflicts happen. A scholar by the name of Abu Madian in Morocco, great scholar. Another scholar differed with him. And he started to argue with him. And he started to call him names. And you know how sometimes how it happens. Said terrible things regarding Abu Madian. One of the students of Abu Madian, because he loved him. Sometimes love causes us to do this. He loved the scholar. He loved Abu Madian. He was so annoyed with that man. So he started responding. He started bashing the other guy, saying things about him. Right? And that student of Abu Madian, one night, he sees a dream. And in a dream, he sees Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I ask you, what would you give to see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one time in a dream? Those who love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know what it means. They're ready to give anything to see him one time. Wallahi, one time. And this man sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he was elated. Oh, Prophet of Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to that student and tells him, what about that man, that other scholar that you're... And he says, didn't you see, O Prophet of Allah? Don't you see what he's saying about Abu Madian? Don't you see how ugly and how terrible of things he's... Don't you see what he's doing? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells him the following. Does he love me? And he says, yes. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells him, wasn't that enough of a reason for you to love him? And the man woke up, oh, what a lesson. And he goes to this man, apologizing, giving him gifts. And the man, what happened? He said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a dream. And he said this and that. And the man started crying. He said that regarding me. Oh, I was wrong. And he went to Abu Madian and things came back to normal. Brothers and sisters, no matter what your opinion is, do you love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Isn't that an enough reason, enough unifying force for me to love you? We pray in the same direction. We are about la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. We have a big mission here in the West. That is a strong unifying force. No matter how you dispute with me, no matter what conflict of interest you have with me, the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the love of Allah will always bind the believers together, no matter what happens. That is the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the rope that no other rope can unify the hearts of this ummah together. When we return to la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, inside and outside. When we stop arguing regarding al-anfal of this life and focus on the purpose of Allah in this life. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين اللهم رد أمة محمد إلى التحقق بلا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة